keep the PowerPoint up for the chorus, let's sing that chorus just again without the organ or the piano. And as we sing Grace, Grace, God's Grace, just think about how the grace of God has been manifested to you personally in your life. You know, it is a big, all-covering grace, but it's also a personal grace that God intends for each one of us to experience. So as we sing this a cappella together, let's just raise the roof as you focus on how God's grace has been manifested towards you. Grace, grace,
God's grace.
Sing that chorus, probably my most favorite word in there is all. All, when you think about it. Greater than all our sin. There's nothing you can do, nothing you can even think of. And that's hard for us to imagine, isn't it? All our sin, God's grace is still greater. Fellowship together as you meet your neighbor this morning. Be seated.
Good morning. We have many folks on our prayer list this week. You would be remembering David Hardy. He had a surgery on Friday, and surgery went well, and he hopefully will be coming home the next day or two. Let's continue to remember Bob Atkinson, as he's recovering. He's at home now recovering. Let's remember Carl Seaborn, as he still would love to be with us, but for problems he's having with his legs, he can't be here. We'll lift him up today, and many others that wish they could be here. And we'll be with Jared and Bradley as they've come through the waters of baptism this morning. Let's go to the Father. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the beautiful day that you've given us to come to your house. Father, we just have already experienced your touch this morning in Sunday school and then through worship and song, Father, and praising you, Father. We just thank you as we can sense your spirit here today. Father, we just ask that you be with us as a congregation to be able to be with Jared and Bradley as they now are new believers in Christ, and it's our responsibility to help to mentor them as one day when we were in that position as a new believer, Father. Such an exciting time, Father. We just thank you for them. Thank you for the opportunity we have. Father, we just ask a special touch on David Hardy as he's in the hospital after this surgery, removing his kidney, Father. And we just ask that you just be with him, touch him, just comfort him and be with him in his recovery, Father. Father, we just ask for a special touch on Carl. We know he would love to be here, and we just ask that you just touch him and be with him, Father, and heal him if it be your will, Father. Father, we have many others that are hurting at home in nursing homes and that can't be here, Father, and we just ask for a special touch for each one of those that they might be able to feel your presence this morning, even as we lift their names up, or we can see their faces as we pray this morning, lifting them up as we remember them in prayer, Father. Father, we ask that you be with the pastor this morning as he brings us the message. Just be with him. Every word that he speaks come from you, Father, and that we just be receptive to be able to hear the word and carry it with us, not just today, but all through the week, that we be able to open your word and be able to renew his word that he gives us today, Father. Be able to carry it with us each day, that we make you number one in our life, as you are the Lord of our lives, Father. And we just are so thankful, Father. Father, we just ask that you just be with the choir as they continue to just lift you up as we praise your name, Father. Be with every one of our visitors. We have many visitors here today, Father. We just ask that you be with them today, that they receive a blessing, Father, from your word and from your spirit in this place. Father, we ask all these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Morning, and we want to extend a welcome to each one of you. If you're not a member or a regular attender at Eastside Baptist Church, you are a special guest. I hope you got a bulletin when you came in. If you did, you're going to see there's a welcome tab on the edge of that bulletin. Please fill that out, tear it off, and drop it in the offering plate because we want to get to know you a little bit better. Also, at the end of the service, I'll be out by the welcome desk. If you are a first-time guest with us, come by and introduce yourself. Or if you brought a first-time guest, bring them by and introduce them because we have a special gift for our first-time guests, and we just want to welcome you. We're going to continue with our service as Alan comes and leads us to know him.
Our offertory hymn is hymn number 166. We'll sing the first, second, and last stanza. May we stand as we sing.
Mercy, there was grace. another day to worship in your house. Pray that you'll be with Pastor Tim. Lord, if there's any lost soul, I pray that you'll just let them be saved. Take these tithes and offer and use it to the further in your kingdom. In your name we pray. Amen.
You've heard the theme this morning on both songs that we have sung so far. We've talked about grace, and the choir special is going to be a sinner saved by grace. We've sung that song before, and if many of you are like me, you know it's not just that we're thankful for when God saved us by His grace, which we are, but it's continued daily. You know, I woke up this morning, and I think I've probably sinned a couple of times between when I woke up and now. So I'm grateful for God's grace ongoing in my life that keeps us there, and God's grace covers all of our sin, not just past, but present and future, and we can rest in that. So if God touches you in any way as we sing this song this morning, feel free to sing along. The choir's not up here performing. We're just up here singing from our hearts, and we invite you to join at any time you'd like as well.
If you could see what I once was, if you could go with me.
Wow, choir, that was wonderful. I'll tell you what, we don't even need a sermon now. Was that a motion? I think Larry seconded it. You have your Bibles, turn with me to the book of Jonah, the Old Testament book of Jonah. We continue through our journey through this wonderful Old Testament book. It is in the second half of the Old Testament with the minor prophets. We call these minor prophets not because they're unimportant, but because they're short books. They're small books, but very important books. If you can't find it, it is on page 813 in my Bible. I don't know if that helps you any. While you're looking for Jonah, let me just tell you that most of us have heard of the Witness Protection Program. Gives the Attorney General of the United States the authority to place any witness in either a federal or a state case under protection if they testify against organized crime. And it's really interesting how they do that. They take a person, they give them a new home in a new location, a new name. The first year, you get a salary of $60,000 from the government. The only restrictions are you cannot return home and you cannot contact anyone that is not a part of the Witness Protection Program from back home. Now, in over 40 years of this program, the United States Marshal's Office says that nobody who has followed the rules has ever been harmed in any way. They are put in this protection program so that they are free to show up at court to tell the truth and to testify on time in the place they're supposed to be so that they can shut down organized crime. In our scripture this morning, we're going to see that thousands of years ago, there was a man by the name of Jonah, a prophet of God, who came up with his own witness protection program. Problem was, the objective of his program was not to allow him to testify, but to keep him from testifying. And he found, like many of us, that you cannot run from God. You can't hide from God. No witness protection program can take you so far away or change your identity so much that God can't find you. What we're discovering as we go through this book is that you can run from God, but you can't outrun God. Jonah chapter 2, beginning in verse 1. Then Jonah prayed to the Lord his God from the fish's belly. And he said, I cried out to the Lord because of my affliction. And he answered me, out of the belly of Sheol I cried, and you heard my voice. For you cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas, and the floods surrounded me. All your billows and your waves passed over me. Then I said, I have been cast out of your sight, yet I will look again toward your holy temple. The waters surrounded me, even to my soul. The deep closed around me. Weeds were wrapped around my head. I went down to the moorings of the mountains. The earth with its bars closed behind me forever. Yet you have brought up my life from the pit, O Lord my God. When my soul fainted within me, I remembered the Lord. And my prayer went up to you into your holy temple. May the Lord add His blessing to the reading of His holy, inspired, and inerrant word this morning. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank You that You have spoken to us in graciousness. You have reached out and spoken to Your people. You did not have to. And we thank You, Lord, that You have loved us enough, that You have given us this love letter this morning. We thank You for Your word. We ask, Lord, that we would hear it and respond to it in faith, that we would be changed and transformed by it, that we might see Your glory in it, that we might see our guilt, and that we might also see Your grace. In Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen. Now in our scripture, Jonah has gotten himself into a whale of a trouble. Now, we always heard, as I was growing up anyway, I always heard that this was the story of Jonah and the whale. Now, other people have said that it wasn't a whale, that it had to be some other kind of fish. I don't know what kind of fish it was. I don't know whether his jail cell was a whale cell or what kind of cell it was. But he was in a fish, that's all we know. What I do know is that if God is God, If he wanted a minnow to swallow Jonah, a minnow would have swallowed him, right? So we see that he is in this situation. He has found himself in this difficult situation because he is running from God. And the problem too many people have when they look at Jonah is they get caught up in what was going on inside the fish. When the truth is, the book of Jonah is all about what's going on inside of Jonah, not what's going on inside the fish. And from that perspective, Jonah really is all about you and me. If I were to interview everyone in this room this morning, I guarantee you that there has been a time in your life, and I know in my own life, when you have run from God and His requirements and His conditions on your life. We've all run from God. Every one of us have done this. And in a crowd this size, I guarantee you this morning, there is somebody here who is running from God right now. You're running from God for a number of reasons. You made a mistake in your past, and you are running from your guilt. Or maybe there was a relationship that didn't work out somewhere along the way, and you're running from your grief over that. Either way, you are running from God's grace. Or maybe God has told you to do something, like Jonah. He has made some condition upon your life, placed some burden upon your life, some request. He's called you to something in your life, and you're running from that, either because you're afraid to do it, or because you arrogantly think that you know better than God does. But you're running from God. You're running from guilt, or grief, or grace. But you're on the run this morning. And frankly, you're tired. You've run so long and so far that you're just too tired to keep on running. You're the one I want to talk to this morning. Because we are learning in this series that it is foolish to run from God. Every time you run from God, you're going to run smack dab into a dead-end street. It's going to end in misery, heartache, and sorrow, and not just for you, you're going to hurt other people around you. You always wound up hurting someone other than yourself when you run from God. Just like the prodigal son, when you run from God, you're going to wind up with pigs as your friends, slop as your food, and a pig pen for your home. You'll also learn that, like Jonah, when you run from God, you'll find that God is also the God of second chances. God is the God of second chances. Let me ask you something. Have you ever heard this old saying, everybody deserves a second chance? You ever heard that? Everybody deserves a second chance. Wrong. Where do you get that? Why does anybody deserve a second chance? You don't deserve a second chance any more than you deserve a third chance, or a fourth chance, or a fifth chance, or a sixth chance. You don't deserve a second chance. You don't deserve another opportunity. And yet, you will find when you blow it, when you make a mistake, when you run from God, when you sin, and you decide that you're not going to run anymore, you're going to find out that our God is the God of a second chance. Not because you deserve it. Doesn't matter how far you have run, how low you have sunk, even in the belly of a fish, maybe you're there today, you're going to find that God is a God of a second chance. Maybe you're here this morning and you find yourself in a belly of a fish of your own making. You've brought yourself to rock bottom. And you're looking around and you realize, I can't blame anybody but myself. My own choices have led me to this place. What we're going to talk about this morning is the fact that no matter how low you have sunk, there are three things that you can do. Three things that if you will do them, if you will do these three things, God will receive you with open arms. He will forgive your sin. He will restore your fellowship with Him. And He will give you a second chance to make the most of your life. So if you're running this morning, I want to give you three steps that when you hit rock bottom, you will find a way out. Step number one, When you have hit rock bottom, when you find yourself in the belly of a fish, when you have absolutely, completely blown it, look up. Look up. Jonah is in the belly of a fish. His head is wrapped in seaweed. He's floating in stomach acid. Yeah, I can't imagine how miserable it would have been to be in the belly of a fish. That's got to be the most miserable place you could possibly be. It's dark. There's no light. He's got air to breathe, but I don't know if you really would want to breathe it. Have you ever had, left fish in the refrigerator just a little too long? And you take that stuff out? Whew! Imagine being wrapped in that. Being encased in a tomb of fish. And think about it. It must have been awfully tight quarters in there. I don't care how big this fish was. It had to be pretty tight. Now, I'm not a real claustrophobic kind of guy. I mean, I'm no more claustrophobic than the next person. But if you've ever had an MRI, you ever have one of those? They put you in that little tube, and it's just right there on top of you, and you're closed in like that. Can you imagine being stuck in something like that for 3 days and three nights? I mean, I had an MRI one time. 20 minutes was about all I could take in that. And here he is. He is stuck in this situation. He is stuck in this fish, in the belly of the fish. And there's nothing he can do to help himself. So the Bible says that Jonah finally looked to the only place that he could look. The only place he could look in the belly of the fish. He looked up. He looked up to the Lord. No matter how deep you are in the fish, or how deep in the ocean the fish has gone, there is one place you can always look. You can always look up to the Lord. When Jonah finds himself in the belly of the fish, remember, he and God are not really on speaking terms at this point. He and Jonah have not been on the best of terms for quite a while, in fact. God's been talking to Jonah. Jonah just hasn't been talking back to him. And here in the belly of the fish, Jonah has finally hit rock bottom. And maybe that's where you are today. You may be at the just rock bottom, wherever that is for you. Maybe here this morning you're thinking, Pastor, you're right. My marriage is at rock bottom this morning. My finances are at rock bottom this morning. Emotionally, I'm at rock bottom this morning. Well, folks, I want you to know, when you find yourself at rock bottom, when you find yourself in the fish's belly, there's one place you can look. You can always look up to the Lord, and He will be there. When every other door in your life closes, God's door will be open. You can always look up. I can't help but see a similarity here between the account of Jonah and the parable of the prodigal son. You all know the story. The prodigal goes to his father, and he asks for his inheritance, and he goes and he squanders all of his money. And when all the money is gone and all the friends are gone, he finds himself feeding pigs, sleeping in a pig pen. He has nothing. He has fallen as low as you possibly can go. Imagine, you're sleeping with pigs. You're eating their slop. He falls as low as he can possibly go. And he's lying there, and all of a sudden it comes to him. It just hits him like a ton of bricks. I could go home. I could go home. Now, he doesn't think at this point that his father is going to receive him as a son. He thinks he's going to have to go home as a servant. But hey, the servants have it better than he does. I can always go home. There's one person that I can always turn to. One person that will always take me back in. My father. As a parent, I think the greatest times when you're able to show your children how much you love them is not when times are going good, when things are going great. When things are going great, you don't have as much of an opportunity to show your kids how much you love them. You know when you really can show them you love them? When things are falling completely apart. That's when you can show them how much you love them. Especially when you have given them good advice and they have not taken it. When you have said, go east, and they have gone west as far as they possibly can. and they have blown it, and they find themselves in the middle of a pig pen, they find themselves in the belly of a fish, and they turn back to you, and you look at them, and in love and compassion, instead of telling them, "I told you so," you reach out and say, "What can I do to help? Because I still love you. Still love you." Because we have a God in heaven that still loves us. No matter how far we have gone, no matter how badly we've messed up, we can always look to the Lord God, and like a good parent, He will receive us. He'll still be there because He loves us unconditionally. If you're at the point where you don't know where to look, you can always look to the Lord. And I want you to know why. When you look up, you're going to find God there because He is the God of a second chance. Now notice something here in Jonah chapter 2, verse 3 here. Jonah says something really strange. Verse 3, he says, "For you cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas, and the floods surrounded me, all your billows and your waves passed over me." He says, "You cast me into the deep." Now, if you were here with us last week and you read this passage of Scripture, you know that that's not exactly what happened. It was the sailors on the boat that cast him into the deep. But Jonah says, no, it wasn't really the sailors who threw me overboard. No, God did that. God did that. And it wasn't really just that a big fish happened along and swallowed me. God prepared the fish. God sent the storm. God prepared the fish. Now, some of you are running from God, and you've run right in the middle of tough times. And you find yourself in just the worst possible situation. You find yourself with marriage troubles, financial troubles, relationship conflict, whatever it is. You run right into problems. I want you to know this morning that is not evidence that God is absent. Some of you think, well, God has abandoned me. God has forgotten me. Folks, it may be the fact that things are going wrong in your life. If you're running from God, it may be evidence that God is active in your life. And God does not send these things into our life in order to make us feel bad, to punish us. He does it to draw us back, to draw us back to Him. It isn't that He's trying to pay us back. He's trying to get us back. He's trying to draw us back into His relationship with Him. If there was ever a time when followers of the living God thought that God was completely absent, it had to have been at the cross of Christ. Put yourself in the situation of the disciples. Here are the 11 remaining disciples. They thought Jesus was the Messiah. He did miracles. They thought He was the fulfillment of the prophecy. And what happens? The Romans crucified Him. They crucified Him. They had to be asking, where is God? Where has God gone? 3 days later, folks, 3 days later, they found out where God was. He was with them all the time. He was right there through it all. So when you run out of other places to look. Look up, and you'll find God there. So the first thing, if you find yourself at rock bottom, you are in the belly of a fish this morning, the first thing you need to do is you need to look up and find the Lord there. And next, you need to speak up. Look at verse 1, Jonah 2, verse 1. "Then Jonah prayed to the Lord his God from the fish's belly, and he said, 'I cried out to the Lord because of my affliction, and He answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol I cried, and You heard my voice.'" Now, this is interesting. Remember back when Jonah was in the bottom of the boat. He went down into the bottom of the boat, and he went to sleep, and the storm comes along, and it's pounding the ship, and the sailors are frantic, they're terrified, and the sailors come down, and they wake him up, and they tell him, "Jonah, you need to pray." Jonah didn't pray there. In the first chapter, Jonah never prays. Jonah never speaks to God in the first chapter. But now he's in the belly of a fish, and all of a sudden now we see him praying. Now when he's got nowhere else to turn, he starts praying. Now when he's in desperation, he begins to pray. Years ago, there was a hurricane in South Florida. And the next morning after the hurricane, there were several men from the neighborhood, from the community, that were out surveying the damage, and they're walking around looking at the damage. And one of the men looks at another one, and he says, "You know, I'm not a real religious guy. I'm not a church-going fella." He said, "But I want you to know, last night I prayed like I've never prayed before." And the other fellow looked at him and said, "Well, I imagine the Lord heard a lot of voices he hadn't heard a long time last night." See, we call on the Lord when we reach rock bottom. We call on the Lord when things are disaster, when things are going bad. That's when we turn to the Lord. If you go back and you look at Jonah chapter 1, Jonah never speaks to God in the first chapter at all. He shut his mouth, he becomes a pouty prophet, and he refuses to speak to God. Now, there's some of you this morning who are angry at God for one reason or another. You're a pouty prophet this morning. You're pouting because you lost this thing or that thing that you loved. Things didn't work out the way you wanted them to. Life is not going just the way you wanted it to. And so you're mad at God, and you've decided you're not speaking to Him anymore. Well, let me warn you, folks. When you decide that you're going to shut God out, God has a way of making you talk. He has a way of making you speak to Him. I have to be perfectly honest. It doesn't take a lot to make me talk. Yeah, I've seen on television, you've seen some of these heroes who are POWs back in during World War II, Vietnam. They're captured by the enemy, and the enemy beat them and tortured them to make them talk. And you see some of these guys, their stories, they were tortured and they didn't talk. Folks, I want you to know, I have a low tolerance of pain. They could hit me one time, and then they'd have to shoot me to shut me up. I'd tell them everything but the recipe to Coca-Cola and Kentucky Fried Chicken, because I don't know those. The Lord knows everything about you. He knows you better than you know you. He knows how to make you talk. He knows how to bring you back into talking with Him, into relationship with Him. And the thing is, if Jonah had spoken to God and told God back in the boat what he told God in the belly of the fish, he wouldn't have wound up in the fish in the first place. But the truth is, he's like you and me. We wait until we get ourselves in a mess, and then we start praying, right? Amen? Like Jonah in verse 2, we call out to the Lord out of our affliction. But the thing is, at this point, God has no real reason to listen to Jonah's prayer. Note that Jonah has no leverage with God at all at this point. There's nothing he can offer God. Yeah, have you ever bargained with God? We've all done this. You ever bargained with God? You ever got on a roller coaster at Six Flags and said, "Lord, if you get me off this thing, I'll go to Sunday school every week. I'll keep the nursery if you'll get me off this thing." Jonah has nothing to bargain with God with. He can't say, "If you get me out of this, I'll do such and such," because there's no life after this. He's dead. I mean, death is the next step for him. He has nothing to bargain with the Lord with. And still, God hears him. Still, God hears him. Folks, if you will speak up, you will hear that God listens. God listens. In his distress, in his mess, he decides to confess, and God heard. There's only one thing, folks, that will ever prevent God from hearing your prayers. It's not location, it's not distance. The only thing that will ever keep God from hearing your prayers is sin. And anytime you are ready to come clean with God and confess your sin to Him, you'll find the same thing that Jonah found, God will hear. Jonah 2, verse 2. "And he said, I cried out to the Lord because of my affliction, and He answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol I cried, and You heard my voice. Folks, if you've been married for more than a year, you've probably had some kind of fight or argument or conflict. Becky and I never have, but I'm sure y'all have. And you know the worst thing that can possibly happen is when your mate just decides to stop talking to you and gives you the silent treatment. As a matter of fact, in counseling, you're taught that the worst possible thing is when you can't get a couple to talk to each other. If you can't get them to talk to each other, you can't save the marriage. It's important to talk. It's important to enter into communication. In the scriptures here, God hears Jonah's voice. God hears Jonah's voice. He responds to him. He gets Jonah talking to him. And he responds. He responds. I heard about a man one time that says the Bible, he read in the Bible that we're not to let the sun go down on our anger. So he said that on their wedding day, he and his wife agreed that they would never go to bed angry at one another. And he said after 60 years, they had always kept that promise. They never went to bed angry at each other. They had to stay up for a week at a time sometimes, but they never went to bed angry at one another. God will not let you give him the silent treatment. He will bring you to that place where you speak to him, and when you do, God will respond. God will respond. Jonah finally starts praying. Now, I don't know about you, but if I'd been God, I'd have responded differently. God will hear and he will respond. Now, if it had been me, I'd have been a little different here. And God, when Jonah starts, he's in the belly of the fish here. He's in a miserable situation. When he starts praying, if I'd been God, you know what I would have done? I would have said, oh, now you want to get chatty. Now you want to talk. If I was God, what I would have said is, really, leave a message at the sound of the beep, and I'll get back to you on the third of never. But God's not like that. God is the God of second chances. If we will look up, we'll find him there. If we will speak up, we'll find that he hears us. Verse 4. Then I said, I have been cast out of your sight, yet I will look again toward your holy temple. The waters surrounded me, even to my soul. The deep closed around me. Weeds were wrapped around my head. I went down to the moorings of the mountains. The earth with its bars closed behind me forever. Yet you have brought up my life from the pit, O Lord my God. When my soul fainted within me, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer went up to you into your holy temple. Twice he mentions the temple here. It's kind of odd that he would mention the temple. Yeah, I think the reason he does that is because God made some promises. In 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 38, he promised the Jewish people a couple things. One of the things he says here is 1 Kings 8:38, whatever prayer, whatever supplication is made by anyone or by all your people Israel, when each one knows the plague of his own heart and spreads out his hands toward the temple, then you will hear in heaven your dwelling place and forgive and act and give to everyone according to all his ways whose heart you know, for you alone know the hearts of all the sons of men. God made a promise. Jonah throws himself on the promises of God. God has promised to hear your prayer. If you will repent, he's promised to hear your prayer. 1 John 1:9 says, if we will confess, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And all you have to do is confess your sin. He's given you a promise. When you hit rock bottom and you have nobody to blame but yourself, look up, God will be there. Speak up, God will hear. And finally, give up. Give up. Jonah says something else really strange here in verse 8. He says, those who regard worthless idols forsake their own mercy, but I will sacrifice to you with the voice of, listen to this, with the voice of thanksgiving. I will pay what I have vowed. Salvation is of the Lord. He says, listen, Lord, I am thankful. I'm thankful. Why is he thankful? He's still in the belly of a fish. I mean, his situation, circumstance has not changed at all. Why is he thankful? God hadn't delivered him yet. He doesn't know if God's going to deliver him at all at this point. Why is he thankful? I believe he's thankful because when he confesses, instantly his relationship with the Lord is restored. Instantly, he gets everything back that he had lost. His joy is restored. His peace is restored. His sense of God's presence is restored. No longer is he alone in the belly of that fish. The Lord is with him now. That's why he's thankful. See, all God ever wanted was for Jonah just to give up. God makes sure that if we run from him, eventually we will surrender to his will. Now, I'm of the opinion that Jonah prayed this prayer immediately after he was swallowed by the fish. Because frankly, I can't imagine being in the belly of a fish more than 5 minutes without praying. I don't think he waited 3 days to pray. He prays, and God still leaves him in the fish for 3 days. Why? Some people think it took 3 days for the fish to get back to land. I don't think that's necessarily so. Some people think, well, God just wanted him to sweat a little bit. He just wanted to kind of turn the knife and watch him squirm. God didn't like that. No, I think it's because God's discipline is thorough. When God teaches us a lesson, he wants to make sure that you have learned your lesson. God says there are consequences in this life for your sin. And when we return to the Lord, when we have sinned and we confess our sin and we come to the Lord, God will forgive us our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We will not die and go to hell because we have eternal salvation. But there are earthly consequences for sin that God does not necessarily lift. And that can include pain, embarrassment, financial loss, physical illness. Because God's discipline is thorough. Remember when Israel rebelled against God in the Old Testament? The Bible says they came to Kadesh Barnea, the edge of the promised land, and they sent spies into the promised land. And most of you know the story. The spies came out. 10 of them said, man, there's no way we can take this land. They got giants. They got walled cities. We were like grasshoppers compared to them. There's no way we can do this. And the people listened to those 10 bad spies. And they said, oh, we aren't going to do this. No way, Lord, don't send us in there. And God told Moses, all right, because you rebelled and would not enter the promised land when I told you to, you're going to wander in the wilderness for 40 more years. Now, what a lot of people forget is that when Moses declared to them, when he said, listen, God says you're going to wander in the wilderness now for 40 more years, the people actually tried to back up. They actually said, oh, we'll go. Don't make us do that. We'll go. We'll go now. Remember what the Lord said? Too late. Too late. Not because the Lord is vindictive, but because his discipline is thorough. His discipline is thorough. When I was a little boy, and I misbehaved, my dad would go for his belt. He would reach down, he would take his belt off, and when I saw my dad take his belt off, I'd start crying and shaking. I would repent in 5 different languages. But I want you to know something, folks. Once he took his belt off, nothing stopped me from getting that spanking. Because if he had repented, if he'd allowed me just by crying and saying I'm sorry, if he had not disciplined me, all I would have learned was that as long as I cry and whine enough, I can get away with anything. He disciplined me so that I would know what a transgression brought. So God allows discipline in our lives. He allows discipline to be thorough. And so for 3 days, he stays in the belly of the fish. I read about a blind man, seeing eye dog one time. He was crossing a street with a seeing eye dog, and he got about halfway across the street with the seeing eye dog, and the seeing eye dog stopped and sat down in the middle of the street. Cars are whizzing by on both sides. The man is terrified. He's shaking and he's cursing at the dog, and the dog won't move. Finally, a bystander sees what's going on, and he rushes out into the road and he grabs the blind man of the dog and he drags them to safety. The blind man is shaking, and he asks the bystander, he said, "Where's my bag of dog treats at?" And the man says, "You're going to give the dog a treat after what he did?" The blind man says, "No, I want to give him a treat so I can find his face and I'll know which end to kick." God knew that Jonah needed a kick in the backside. He knew that he needed discipline. He needed discipline. And that's what he got. 3 days in the belly of the fish. What was the result? Jonah says, "I will pay what I've vowed. I will pay what I've vowed. From this point on, where God sends me, I will go. I will completely give up to God. I surrender to God now. I give up." If you want heaven and the assurance of eternal life, you have to completely give up to God. Surrender must be unconditional. There is no such thing as partial repentance. Whatever your problem is, you have to give up and give in to God. Do it now. Do it today, not tomorrow. Every day you run from God is a wasted day in your life. In Exodus chapter 8, we have the story of Israel and Egypt and the 10 plagues. If you remember the story, there was a point where God sends a plague of frogs on Egypt. And Egypt is covered with frogs. Can you imagine what that must have been like? You get up in the morning, there are frogs in your shoes. There's frogs in your bed. You go to eat, there's frogs in your bowl. There's frogs in the water. There's frogs in everywhere you go, frogs everywhere. And so Moses comes to Pharaoh, and Pharaoh's sitting there on his throne. And can you imagine? He's sitting there, he's covered in frogs. And Moses walks in, he says, "Just give up. Give up to God. Just surrender to God, and I'll give the command, the frogs will go." And Pharaoh's sitting there, frog on his head. And he says, "Come back tomorrow. Come back tomorrow. One more night with the frogs." Why? Why are you going to endure one more night with the frogs? Why are you going to endure one more night in the belly of a fish? Give up. Give up now. Give in to God. Some of you this morning are in the belly of a fish. You have been swallowed alive by your mistakes and your sin. You're overwhelmed by guilt. And maybe you have convinced yourself, or more likely, the devil has convinced you, that there's no hope for you. You have blown it so bad that there is no coming back from this. There's just no coming back from this. Folks, that is a lie from the devil. I'll tell you a little story about my dad. My dad was an alcoholic. He drank most of my life. He struggled with all sorts of things. He lost jobs. He wouldn't stop drinking. And then one day at 63 years old, he's working a construction site, 63 years old, he fell off the ladder, was severely injured, wound up Duke Medical Center, was up there for a couple weeks. For a while, they weren't sure he was going to live. Lying in that hospital bed, my dad hit rock bottom. He hit rock bottom. But as he was lying there in that hospital bed, he repented of his sin. He turned to Jesus. He was gloriously saved. And I remember 20 years later in his 80s, him standing in church and giving his testimony, and with tears in his eyes, he thanked God for 20 years that he could give the Lord. My children growing up never knew him as an alcoholic. All they knew him as was a godly man who read his Bible every day and was a deacon in the church. That's all they knew him. My father is an example of how our God is a God of second chances. To his dying day, my dad was grateful that at his lowest moment, He looked up to God, and God was there. He spoke up, and God heard him. And when he gave up, God showed him grace. If you're here this morning, and you have never looked up to God, spoke up in confession of your sin, and given up to God, today's the day. Don't spend another day with the frogs, another night with the frogs. Don't spend another day in the belly of the fish. Give up now. Give up now. God offers us salvation. The Bible says we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God, and the wages of sin is death, separation from the blessing presence of God forever in a place called hell. And the gift of God is eternal life, and all we have to do is receive it. If you will confess with your mouth the Lord God and believe that God, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe with your mouth God raised him from the dead, you will be saved today. Just a moment, I'm going to be standing here at the front. If you don't know Christ as your Savior today, I'm going to invite you to step out loud, come to the front and say, Pastor, I want to know this Jesus. Or just come up here and say, I give up. I know what you mean. I'll pray with you. I'll show you how you can know Jesus as your Savior this morning. Maybe you're a Christian. You're a believer in Christ. But you have been running from God. He has made some requirement of you. He put some kind of requirement on you. He's called you to something. He's convicted you of sin, and you've been running from God. You need to give up today. Give up today. Maybe you're still in the boat. You haven't found yourself in the belly of the fish yet. Don't wait till then. Don't wait till then. Look to God. Speak up and give up. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are a God of second chances. We thank you for your grace, your mercy, and your kindness, and your willingness to forgive us of our sins. We ask, Lord, that if there's any here this morning who is running from you, that, Lord, that you would help them to give up and surrender to Christ, that they would get right with you. We pray for that one especially that doesn't know Jesus as their Savior. We ask that you would draw them to salvation, convict them of their sins, and draw them to Christ this very morning that you might be glorified in it. In Jesus' name, amen.